I'm back.
Go ahead.
Go ahead. Okay. Thank you. The expression taking the words right out of my mouth. Welcome back. This is Daybreak. We now get straight into the discussion. Chapter 6, Leadership and Integrity. And this comes even as EACC officials currently raiding the two homes of Governor Ferdinand Waititu of Kiambu, his Runda home and Garden Estate home as well. We're told they're also looking for 15 other individuals, amongst them county officials, over graft allegations. They're looking for documents. As to why, we still don't know. But when we have that information, we will relate to you. And that's something I actually want to get a feel of from my guest here in studio, Gladwell. I'll come to you for that. You can comment on that, even as you tell us about the report that you released yesterday and its motive. Why this report? Why now? Especially if what John said is true, that it didn't necessarily have anything new. Mm-hmm. But there was an intention. Share that with us.
Okay. Well, as far as the raid by the EACC, I don't know the background. I think this is typical of the sort of actions we're talking about, this sort of dramatic, dramatic actions which sort of raise public attention. We don't know substantively how effective that investigation is, and as was said earlier, effective investigations are a problem. Mm-hmm. and cases which are brought to court rarely succeed, also because investigations are not being done properly. So, you know, the public is allowed a certain amount of skepticism about the true motives behind this raid and the possibility of getting any sort of effective result from it. As far as the report is concerned, what we were concerned about doing was injecting a new impetus into the discussion. We've been at this, as John said. He's been working on anti-corruption for decades, for 20 years, and we've gone through this. We've said we need laws, we need an anti-corruption commission, etc. And what we're saying now is that we want to start a new conversation about the nature of corruption. Why is it that despite all of these actions over the last two decades, corruption has not only not gone away, it's gotten even worse than it ever was, as was pointed out before. And what we're saying is that the problem is the capture of the state by a small cartel of powerful individuals on the business side and on the political side for their own ends. And you cannot expect these same people who are benefiting from corruption to fight corruption effectively. So we want Kenyans to realize that it's not something they can sit back and watch the EACC raiding somebody's house or the president coming out with his State of the Nation addresses and lists of shame, etc. This is about a much deeper problem, because the nature of state capture means that institutions are captured, institutions are demobilized, they're weakened, and that our democracy is under threat.
All right. Joy, what do you make of this entire fiasco? Now EACC is raiding Kiambu governor's homes, and we've seen this happen before and then nothing comes out of it. Edwin Gisemba on Twitter here is saying short investigation with so much publicity. Is there a breakdown in the systems in the manner in which we do things? And you're supposed to have a reason why you're coming to raid my house in the first place, because we're seeing a situation where people are being arrested and then they look for evidence later rather than the other way around.
One of the biggest tragedies I think we've seen this year is the president, I don't know whether it is by design or it just happened, has been having a lot of senior officers appointed from the NIS. What you do have when you have that is that you've got heads of these separate institutions who ought to be distinct from each other thinking the same. And when they think the same, then they start coordinating how they do their activities. So if you pick a phone and tell a guy and he's known you from way back when, he goes on that word and he acts on it. So case in point, what we saw with Governor Obado. So they say, you know what, I think we have this guy. And by the time now you do the actual work of investigation, you realize, oops, it was an error. And you're left with egg in your face. I think there are several things that are at play here. One, like I alluded to earlier, the nature and the way corruption is done has grown smarter. Our systems have not. Our investigators, maybe they're catching up to it, but sometimes they are not as smart as. And so the criminals are always one step ahead. So you may go and read and find plenty of stuff and comb through it And there's actually nothing of property value that you can use in a court of law. There's no evidence. That's one. Then secondly, the way we do our things these days as Kenyans, it's more for the show. In 2 days, they'll have forgotten. So let's do this thing, keep them happy that something is progressing. Remember the time when the headlines, it was every day, boom, boom, boom. Where has that left us? And so you've got all these people left with all these stories of doom and gloom, and at the end of the day, nothing percolates. One of the things I think we can do, in addition to dealing with state capture, which, by the way, I think is the biggest tragedy of our times, because we not only have big business in bed with politics, now you've got people looking for politics as a means of driving big business. Mm. And so you've got somebody who knows he probably has got some criminal activities that would likely land him in jail. So you become a person of influence so that you can subvert the course of justice. So you did not seek office because you wanted to serve Kenyans. You sought office so that you can keep yourself from being investigated. We've got others who want to run for office genuinely and don't have the power to do it, but get benefactors. But once they get into power, then you're beholden to the people who sponsored you to get there. So you have to keep them in business. Then we've got what we've been discussing earlier, where business, when government policy is geared towards business. Remember like the infamous example of somebody passing a law that all seatbelts must be fitted by Monday, while there was actually a container on the high seas with this bunch of safety belts already coming. So this entire, our entire quagmire, I think we've gotten to a place where we are setting ourselves up for failure. But the people with the responsibility, like we're talking about Chapter 6. Chapter 6 was very elaborate. Kenyans knew exactly what they wanted. But when we came to passing the Leadership and Integrity Act, we subverted this entire process because it's the act that gives life to the Constitution. Mm-hmm. So if you've got a weak statute, then everything you have said becomes null and void. That's why we actually have a provision that says if you are accused of corruption, until you have exhausted all available mechanisms of exonerating yourself, you cannot have political consequences for your accusations and your actions, which is absolutely ridiculous. In other countries, you step aside, and when you're cleared, then you resume office. In Kenya, it's the other way around.
It's the other way around. George, let me bring you in. The question that we're asking our viewers this morning is, what is the missing link in the war on corruption? And of course, they're weighing in. We're getting so many SMSs here, and I'll read a few of them right now. But some are of the opinion that it's no longer just about a missing link. It's a much bigger issue, and Kenyans need to look at it that way if they are to genuinely tackle it. And Gladwell says that was the motivation for the release of the report yesterday. What are your thoughts on this?
I think we've touched on it in different ways. I think it isn't a missing link. You've got to go back to Moi was no anti-corruption fighter. We now know that. But Moi set up, he brought Kroll, not, he brought these...
The commission.
No. He brought a British investigative agency to advise him on the fight against corruption. Remember that? And there was a lot of fanfare around it, and they came and interviewed us and wrote a nice report. That was Moi's way of doing things for a show. So these arrests these guys are making, including of Waititu, including of the 21 billion dams. So it wasn't 21 billion, it was only 7 billion. So, but what are the consequences of the 7 billion? Nothing. All that has been, the slate has been cleaned because there was never seriousness. There's never seriousness because ultimately it's a leadership problem. The people that are in charge of leadership are also the corrupt. So it's like cutting the tree where you are, on whose branch you are currently sitting. If it comes down, it will hurt you.
It will come down with you.
So, and they know that. So they will do the minimum necessary in order to survive. How have they managed So their tactics they employ to survive. One is the need from time to time to manage pressure by building an appearance of motion, something is being done and so on and so forth. Two, they need to keep us divided. That's key. That's key and important. We need to remain divided, and I said something about it at the beginning. When we got as divided as happened after 2005 and the 2007 violence, those divisions need to be maintained, nursed, and promoted for purposes of survival.
So those are the thoughts of the political class.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So if it is not so and so in at this time, now the group that is corrupt for the time being is Ruto's group. Why is Ruto's group suddenly corrupt? Because they are the ones who are being made political outsiders. When they are political insiders until after the last election, they were fine. They are suddenly corrupt. Mm. So it and anybody who supports Ruto and the power group and the power base he draws out of, that is where the corruption is. It just happens to be that's where the corruption is. So it is how political divisions that have existed and have never been addressed are then recalibrated at every point to ensure that we are kept divided. Uh-huh. and we keep away.
So can citizens only watch as these events unfold without being able to do anything? If the whole section of the political class is thinking that way, what can citizens do?
Well, citizens have allowed themselves, I mean, the divisions are deep. Okay, the third strategy, and then I can answer your question. I don't know whether I have an answer for it, but I can try and answer your question. The third strategy that these people then have is violence itself. Mm. If manipulating you with information and appearances of motion, and if dividing you doesn't work, the third option that they have is they will actually clobber you.
Can you do now on the other side?
Mm-hmm. What you need to do is to organize outside of. So the first thing is to come to a realization that they are not serious. They never were and would never be. So that's an important thing. Getting citizens to realize that you are being manipulated. These people are not your saviors at all. Yeah. They are actually devouring you and using your taxes to devour you. That requires a huge amount of organizing to realize. But that nothing can be done until that realization happens. And the report yesterday is an important contribution towards the path of realizing that we have been duped and we will always remain duped unless we do something about it.
John, I'd like to hear you, because before we come to you, Joy, I'd like to hear John's view on this. And it's a very interesting perspective where you guys bring out the citizens' role. You tried this before, and there's a court case that slapped you with a 27 million shilling fine, which brings another concern on the threshold of what we say out there and whistleblowing. Is there, what do you think, what do you make of that ruling, number one? And is that an institutional breakdown in your view? Because then if I have information and I saw what happened to John, there's a very high chance I will not bring it up.
I'm not in a position, because I have a matter
you're
before court
it, yes,
to be able to comment about it. But this is a struggle that has been there. This is my fifth court case, so it comes with the territory. So it's not really. But you know, I go back to throw something in there. The challenge to you, good people of the media as well, that the mobilizers of public opinion around issues like integrity, leadership, the fight against corruption, are to a very great extent media, the churches, and civil society. Mm-hmm. And I maybe I have been missing in action for quite some time, but it has been quite some time since the head of KHRC, head of AFRICOG, and myself have been invited to a place like this to talk about this kind
exactly.
of issue. So perhaps something is changing.
These guys had given up on us.
Yes. And of course these arrests and are exciting. Yeah. You know, when you see people in courts wearing masks like ninjas and all that kind of thing, it's very exciting. But I think Kenyans have seen through that.
Yeah.
And as George said, this is a political game that is being perpetrated on the Kenyan people quite deliberately and quite cynically. And I think that people are realizing that, especially as the cost of living goes up and people begin to connect the cost of living with the corruption that is taking place. That connection has become much easier to make, and realizing that ultimately we are victims of participating in a political failure, a deliberate political failure that is being managed. And now we are being managed to make sure that we don't respond in a manner that upsets the status quo that is very profitable to a very small number of people who are borrowing like school children. You know, the irony was lost even on us, even on media, that the cabinet secretary for Ministry of Finance can be announced in the headlines in the newspaper saying that we are going to float another Eurobond to pay for the previous one. Now, a Dukawala does not do that. Does not go to the bank and say, listen, I borrowed 10,000 shillings last month. Now, I can't pay the 10,000 shillings. Can you give me another 10,000 shillings? And so simple things like that get lost in all the hot air and manipulation that is happening. And sometimes it's just to tear it down and say, listen, and this has become more and more apparent, that even the nature of our political class has changed. So for the first time, and I won't mention names, but I know you know them, we have people who are mentioned repeatedly with regard to the drugs trade, who have penetrated our political system, who are in parliament, who are in positions of public trust. When you have that kind of situation, and I've seen it especially in Latin America and other countries, it changes the quality of your politics fairly dramatically, and it degrades the politics. It hits, first of all, the first institution which changes very dramatically is the police force, which is corrupted. Judiciary gets hit very hard. Once these forces are allowed to enter into the ecosystem of justice and governance, we begin to see the kind of contradictions we are seeing now, where we have on the front pages of our papers regularly dramatic arrests. We're being shown big boxes with millions, but deep down we all know it means absolutely nothing.
To fizzle out. Mm-hmm. All right. Gladwin, I'll come to you in just a bit, but we have to take a quick break. What I'd like you to respond to is a view here from Wilfred Okeye, who says Kenya should strengthen one agency to fight corruption. These several agencies bring divergent opinions on matters of corruption. And we have a lot of your feedback coming through to our newsrooms. 224222 is the number you can use. You can call in 0719-777-777 at Citizen TV Kenya, Trevor Mbidi, at Waiga Mwaura, at Zinzi K. Let's bring up some of your feedback before we take that quick break and then come back and discuss whether we should have one institution to fight graft.
All right, at P. Bunyore says, a machine can do what people cannot. How can technology and automation be used to eliminate corruption? How can one using the ICC to eliminate corruption? Okay, I hope that's the International Criminal Court. ICT. How can biometrics, thank you, Gladwell. How can biometrics be used to eliminate corruption? Asking wrong questions gets wrong answers.
All right. Let's see. Francis Kigondu says, our constitution was a mistake. It speaks of goals that cannot be achieved in Kenya with the dispensation it creates. Other countries have achieved this integrity status with backward constitutions. The US is an example that one man can make institutions irrelevant.
Okay.
Very strong views.
International perspective there. Let's take a look at, SMSs coming in. 2242 is the line there. Thomas from Nairobi, the missing link is pressure from the masses. Remember how the masses arrested cops when Kigali came in?
Kibaki.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Today, the masses have now been confused by the likes of Huduma number, fake Aror Dam, fake arrest, fake anti-corruption statements, fake gold, and the tribal card.
All right, we still have more. Robert says, I'm just worried about our country because we don't respect our constitution. In fact, if you're suspected in corruption, just you step aside and resign from whichever office you're in. We talk about the issue of stepping aside and when it happens is next.
Shadra Kongeri from Kitale, arrest, prosecute and jail corrupt individuals. Until then, corruption remains a lifestyle watered by empty threats.
Right. Komen from Eldred says, Chapter 6 of our constitution has been with us for close to 9 years now, with very little to show for it. The many graft allegations against those in leadership is a testimony to this. The still continuation, we have also failed to socialize the next generation on this crucial value. Now we are grappling over very young so-called flamboyant businessmen who are simply crooks. The future looks bleak for ignoring this chapter.
Okay. Engineer Lazaro Kanyembok from Kariobangi. Judiciary is the biggest letdown in the war against graft, delaying cases with intentions, then finally releasing suspects because of the lack of sufficient evidence. Okay. Taking a finger at the judiciary.
Dima of Nyeri says the missing link is between professionals, policy programs, and politicians. The political pillar is baking and eating its own cake.
And I think we have one more. Benjamin Kobare from Ahero. Genuine vetting of office bearers. We need to vet them and weed them out at appointment or interview level.
All right, we still have another one.
We have one more, okay.
Alvin Mwema from Kitui West. The war on corruption literally lacks the integrity of the fashion in which the government of Kenya is trying to fight this corruption menace. There's a continuation. If only the government will copy other countries in the West, where big fishes are arrested on involvement in corruption and charged in a court of law and two resigns, then the war on corruption will remain to be a lullaby in this country.
Very emotive issue. You can just see so many suggestions.
Yes, and we're trying to edit out. Those are some of the texts we could read on air.
They're palatable for general consumption.
Yeah, we'll come back with more on this and find out the solutions next. You've talked about technology, pressure from the masses, people stepping aside, and whether the judiciary is the weakest link. We'll speak about all that when we return.